In this lecture, we're going to study the nuts and bolts of ray tracing. What are the steps you need to actually write a ray tracer as in your homework assignment? We start with discussing camera ray casting, and in subsequent segments, we'll talk about ray object intersections, ray tracing transformed objects, lighting calculations, and recursive ray tracing. Notice the outline in the code that I've shown here. What we're interested in this lecture is this part. How do I shoot a ray so that it goes through a given pixel, ij, in the image plane? Let's go back to our diagrams of ray casting. Here we have the virtual viewpoint of the camera. It shoots a ray through a pixel, misses all the objects, it's colored black. The ray through the next pixel hits an object, and you shade it using the colors, the lights, the material properties. Then you shoot a ray that goes through multiple intersections, and as in OpenGL, you pick the closer intersection and you shade that point. What this segment is about is choosing the ray direction for each pixel. So the goal is to find the direction given a pixel I and j. There are, of course, multiple ways in which you can approach this problem. You can consider the objects to be in world coordinates, and then you find the direction of each ray. In fact, this is what we do. Alternatively, you can transform the objects into the camera's coordinate frame as an OpenGL, essentially applying the gluLookAt transform. Then the camera is in a canonical frame and it's clear what the rays do. However, we'll consider the camera at some location in space and we'll consider everything in world coordinates. A ray, as you know, has an origin, which is the camera center, and the direction. The goal is really to find what this direction should be, given the camera parameters and the pixel locations I and j. The camera parameters are as in gluLookAt, so they are in the look from, which is the camera location, the look at, which is where is the camera looking at, the up direction, and the field of view. So once again, the parameterization is very similar to gluLookAt, and the diagram is exactly the same as in the earlier lecture on deriving gluLookAt. You have an eye here, you're looking at some object here, and this is the up direction. So the steps we take are very similar to what we did in the derivation of gluLookAt, if you remember. First, we construct a coordinate frame. The slide here comes from a very early lecture in this course, where given two vectors A and B that may not be normalized and may not be orthogonal to each other, you want to create this U, V, and W coordinate frame. First, you associate W with A, but you normalize it. Then there's this neat trick to get the U vector, which is the cross product of B and W. And that ensures that the components of B along W are not considered, only the orthogonal component is considered. And then you can say B is equal to W cross U. Now, how do you determine A and B? Well, the vector A is simply given by I minus center, at least following the OpenGL convention, where the camera looks down the minus Z axis and it's at the origin. The vector B is simply the up vector. So given I and center, we can find a vector A, find a vector V, and then apply this coordinate frame to find U, V, and W from A and B. So let's now talk about the canonical viewing geometry. We have the vectors U, V, and W, but we haven't said how to find the direction for a given camera pixel I and J. First, let's consider where the virtual image plane is. It is located, for now, one unit away from the camera. Remember that the camera in OpenGL is at the origin looking down the minus Z axis. In our case, we're considering world coordinates, so we are still in world coordinates and the camera looks down the minus W axis. For that reason, the world, or rather the image plane through which the world will be observed, is at minus W, one unit in the minus W direction. Now consider what happens to the ray through a given pixel. And we've already seen the W coordinate is just minus 1 along the W axis. But this ray also moves a certain direction alpha along the U vector, which corresponds to horizontal pixels, and beta along the V vector, which corresponds to vertical pixels. So all that remains is to derive what alpha and beta are. Let's first consider the derivation of alpha. So this is the width, and we'll call it J. Furthermore, we label width as going from 0 to a final width, let's call it W. And therefore, we really have to consider the positive values of J to be centered around W divided by 2. Therefore, what we're interested in is this value J minus width by 2 and normalize the whole thing with width by 2. That's the normalized amount you're moving along the x direction. It goes between minus 1 and plus 1 along the image. Okay, so what happens if this value is equal to plus 1? Well, so if this value is equal to plus 1, then you've gone the full extent here, and therefore the angle will be corresponding to the field of view in the x direction. So what we really want to consider is from the way the triangles are, you consider the triangle from here, and this will correspond to the tangent of the field of view in the x direction. But because we're considering half the field of view, so if you consider the full field of view, this whole thing will be the field of view. But we are considering half the field of view. And since it's one unit here, the remaining dimension corresponds to the tangent. So this whole thing will be multiplied by the tangent of the field of view in the x direction. And indeed, that's what I've shown in the slide, that the alpha coordinate is the tangent of field of view in the x direction divided by 2 times j minus width by 2 normalized by width by 2. Beta for the y direction is exactly the same. It's tan field of view y divided by 2 times, and now there's just a side change. So you change height by, you say height divided by 2 minus I instead of I minus height by 2. And there's a very simple reason for that. If you consider the image, we typically have 0, 0 starting in the upper left. So while J goes from left to right, as you would expect, I actually goes from top to bottom. So value of I equal to 0 is really plus 1. And so if I is equal to 0, this will actually be plus 1 correctly. Whereas the value of I equal to height here will be minus height by 2 divided by height by 2, which will be minus 1, which is what's desired. And so simply because of the standard pixel naming conventions, we have to invert what happens along the y direction or along the I pixel. Finally, given alpha and beta, the direction is easy. So you just have alpha u plus beta v minus w. And now you have to normalize it. So you have to divide by the norm. And this is what the final ray looks like. It starts at the I, and so this is the origin. And this value here is the normalized direction. So let me write this as direction. And in fact, this is a vector, and this I is also a vector, this is also a vector, times some distance along the ray. So this T corresponds to the distance along the ray. That is what the origin and direction for the camera eye rays corresponds to.